and problems, Lord. We are unworthy, Lord, even, Lord, to listen to thy word. Looking to my rebellious nature, our unsanctified nature, yet, Lord, in your mercy, you speak to us. This night also, Lord, speak to our hearts from thy word, in Jesus' name. Amen. We will turn to chapter 8 of Daniel. There are few very important things, God willing, we will learn today. I hope you will listen. Verse 1 and 2, chapter 8. Of course, you will not close that chapter because mainly we speak from that. Verse 1 and 2. In the third year of the reign of King Belshazzar, a vision appeared unto me, Daniel, after that which appeared unto me at the first. And I saw in a vision, and it came to pass when I saw that I was at Shushan in the palace, which is in the province of Elam. And I saw in a vision, and I was by the river of Ulai. Now, something important now we have to learn. If we read right from the almost right from the beginning to the end, we read about dreams and visions. And right from the beginning of the Bible, we find dreams and visions. Particularly, we realize how important are these visions that Daniel had. Now, how to discern our dreams? That's an important thing that we need to know. Recently, I was able to hear from some people, they are very disturbed about some dreams they get. Some people are often haunted by frightening dreams. I hope I will quickly go through this because that gives how important about the visions and dreams. How to discern dreams? Oh, more than visions, I would say dreams. First point, anything confusing in your heart and is not clear is not from God. Because we read in the word of God, God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. When God speaks through any dream, it will be very clear. The dream will be clear. And of course, meaning either initially or later on, it will be cleared. And it will be never, when God speaks, it will not be confusing at all. So if you find any dreams confusing, you should not believe that. And second thing, if you see very often frightening and discouraging dreams, it is not from God. But if you find any dreams which will give godly fear to walk with God, and it will encourage you to draw closer to God, although it may have so many troubles and difficulties or problems may be mentioned there, there may be something fearful also. But if it will help us to have a godly fear and to encourage our spiritual life, it's from God. But if it is discouraging and if you feel like giving up after seeing that some visions or some dreams, they are not from God. Because anything that is coming from God, there is life, there is light, there is grace, there is encouragement. There are so many people get some dreams and they get disturbed about it. And also I will come to say how, then what to do if we get dreams which is you are not able to understand whether it is from God or from devil. That will come next. I will try to go quickly, but I hope you will listen carefully. One thing that we find, devil also can give us dreams. And in Ecclesiastes chapter 5 verse 3, what we read, sometimes there are some other reasons also for dreams other than given by God. Here we find verse 3, for a dream cometh through the multitude of business. That NIV says, dreams comes where there are many cares or worries. If you are a person of worry and anxiety and care, there is a great possibility often you will get dreams. And definitely such dreams will not be from God. here that NIV says dreams comes where there are many cares or worry. So because of our cares and worries, we may get some dream. Forget example. You are all the time worried about losing your job. And you go to bed. And what do you see? You are losing your job. And oh, any other thing that we are worried about it, and then you see that. Another reason that we find, the same Ecclesiastes chapter 5 verse 7 says, for in the multitude of dreams and many words, there are also diverse vanities. That very verse in the NIV says, much dreaming and many words are meaningless. NIV gives the right meaning. Much dreaming and many words are meaningless. Some people, when they, as soon as they close their eyes, they keep dreaming. And they imagine that all the dreams are given by God. No. But here says, much dreaming and many words are meaningless. So don't imagine every dream has got a meaning and you keep on telephoning the faith home and asking the meaning of all those dreams. You don't need. And so, let me quickly come to. So, suppose you see often frightening dreams and discouraging dreams, and you do not know whether God is speaking or devil is speaking, what should you do? And take for granted that you have nobody to go to and ask. Maybe you may be in a faraway place, or you are not in a situation where you could ask. One thing you can do in such situations, where you do not know whether it is from God or from the devil, and if you feel confused and discouraged and frightened about it, whether it is from God or man, what you can do, from first SB Ernest only I learned this lesson. We can tell the Lord, Lord, don't speak to me through dreams, because I don't know whether it is you are speaking or devil speaking. Therefore, kindly don't speak to me through dreams. And why God can answer that prayer, there are several reasons. One thing, in the Old Testament time, they had no other, particularly Genesis, we read Abraham and Joseph and many others, they only had dreams because there was no Bible. There was no word of God given. The Holy Spirit was not given as an abiding experience. So they have to rely upon the dreams. I don't know how during that time they lived. How they were able to discern, I do not know. Maybe that time, depending upon the period, God might have given them grace to understand that. But in the New Testament, what is the proof to say that we don't need to always depend upon the dreams? Of course, God can give dreams. In the New Testament also, we read that Joseph had a dream, take the child and go to Egypt, etc., etc. Obeyed. But now the whole New Testament is full. And also, we read in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 2, 1 and 2. God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. Although in the past days, this text says, in the past days, although God has spoken at sundry times in diverse manners, in different ways God spoke in the past. But now God is speaking through the Son, through the Word of God. So, if you feel confused about some dreams, and often you are getting dreams, you have every right to tell the Lord, Lord, I am confused about it, therefore please don't show any dreams. At least till such time my confusion is gone. God will surely honor us, because more than dreams or visions, the greatest emphasis is in the New Testament is on the Word of God. Even if some good dreams that we find is, if it is in conflict with the Word of God, we shouldn't take. So if there is anybody here who has got a problem that you get frightening dreams very often, today you tell the Lord, Lord, don't speak to me through dreams. You can, then what God will do? God can speak to us through the Word of God. And another thing, suppose now about the voice you hear. You don't know whether God is speaking or devil is speaking. Then what should you do? The same thing can apply into your life. Lord, now for the time being, I do not know whether you are speaking or God is speaking or devil is speaking. So therefore, Lord, don't speak to me in my ears or in my heart. You show me the word of God. Then God will speak the word. We can listen to the word of God. What we hear in the word of God, if we hear the word of God, we can believe. Because the word of God, as we heard, it is settled in heaven. That cannot be changed. Sometimes God will tell us, take such and such verse. This week somebody told, who was very much confused about dreams, that person told, Lord, don't speak to me through dreams. Immediately, you know what the Lord told? Read Genesis 18:1. And that really encouraged that dear child of God. And when the child of God read this, the Lord appeared to him, to Abraham, in Mamre. So that really encouraged that child of God. So, and after you speak to the Lord, Lord, don't speak to me through dreams. Afterwards, again dream comes, you don't believe that dream. Again, for a short time, there is a possibility, again you may get such frightening dreams. But when you don't believe it, and you are not frightened anymore about it, realizing it is from the devil, then the devil will stop bringing the dreams. Same way, if you hear that you don't know and you don't have the discerning ability to know whether it is from God or from devil, anything that you are hearing, you can tell the Lord, Lord, don't, at the moment, don't speak to me. Because I don't know whether you are speaking or devil is speaking. Surely God will honor. That's what Pastor Ernest, SBNS told me. Then what God will speak through the word. And we read in Hebrews chapter 1 already the authority for that. In the past, through diverse manners, God spoke to our fathers. But now through the Son, He speaks. That is through the word of God. So that way we can discern. Another important thing. This I am telling so that we may not make any mistakes. Even if you get a good vision, a right sort of thing, if it is something that you have to, a vision that you have to make an action about it, an important matter you have to decide, just by getting a vision, don't do that. You need to consult others. Word of God says, in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. Anyway, before we go to the Old Testament, we'll read in the New Testament. The point I was emphasizing, please listen. Suppose you get a vision, something, a very clear vision, and that is connected with making a decision, an important decision. Still, don't immediately react like that. How do we know? Please read what Paul did. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 16. Now please listen, see verse 9 and 10. Here, Paul had a vision. Now what did he do when he had a vision? He was such a saintliest man. Even the saintliest man, when he got a vision, what did he do? We read here, and a vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, come over into Macedonia and help us. So this was the vision that Paul had. Come over to Macedonia and help us. So what did Paul do? He didn't say, yes, Barnabas, Silas, come. God has given me a vision. Let us go to Macedonia. The next verse says, what did he do? And after he had seen the vision, immediately we, look that word, we endeavored to go into Macedonia, assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us for to preach the gospel unto them. We assuredly gathered, not I was sure, we all were sure about that. See the unity there. He didn't say, I had the vision. Whether you agree or not, I am the holiest person. You better come with me. If you don't come, I am going to go. I will show you whether I had the vision or not. That's not the right thing. We assuredly gathering, that means all were in agreement. Recently when I went to India, I saw one young brother in one part of India. He had some sort of funny voice, something that he had a very good job and he resigned the job, wandering around the streets now, going around here and there. His wife told servants, I asked, did you ask anybody before resigning? Yes. Did you ask wife? Yes. What did he say? Don't do that. Did you ask the servants of God? Yes. What did they say? Don't do that. But still he says, what I did is correct. He seems to be almost losing his salvation now. He says, what I had was correct. But word of God is not so. Paul had the vision and said, we were assuredly gathered that we were called there. And that is what we read in the Old Testament also, in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. So if you, Proverbs, chapter 16, not 16, 11, 14. Yes. Here we find, where no counsel is, the people fall. But in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. So, we have safety in the multitude of counselors. Otherwise, suppose, I know some cases like that. Say the wife is getting bitter against the husband. And, so many ways the bitterness is developing. And she will go and pray, Lord, what should I do? What should I do? Perhaps she may hear, my daughter, divorce him. My daughter, better you divorce him. Who is speaking that? Her own bitter spirit is speaking to her. And then she will say, God spoke to me to divorce my husband. Yes, God repeatedly spoke to me. Did anyone hear that anytime? God speaking to you to divorce your husband or divorce your wife? I'm sure, I hope you all are all right in your family life or married, I suppose. Anyway, so in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. So, word of God is very clear about visions and dreams. Sometimes it may come to deceive us. So many people, those who left smoking, afterwards, when they really go on with the Lord, one day they will get a dream. Devil may try through some friends giving cigarettes and things. They will not accept it. Finally, what the devil may try to do? A dream. In the dream, what does he see? He is smoking again. I know about a brother, all night he was so disturbed and cried. Because he saw, like that people, those who have given up drinks, they see dream. In the dream, they will be drinking. And then they get discouraged. Anyway, I had seen in my dream, I am drinking. So what is, sometimes, is what you have given up, the devil may show to do that. So many, even recently, some number of people told me about various dreams. What is it? Sometimes what desire you have in your heart also will come as a dream. And then you will think, see, what I thought to do, that same thing that God has spoken tonight through a dream. No, that cannot be true. So, in the first place, it should be, tallying, or it should be conforming to the word of God. And then, let me quickly tell a couple of other things also. And why some people hear strange voices? One day, I think in a Bible study, I spoke about that. Some people hear all the strange voices. Say, for example, kill yourself and jump from the bridge, fall into the sea, and or perhaps kill that person, or do this, or do that. Something, strong voices coming for some people. Have you seen some people like that? Strange things they hear. Not only that, other things also. Yes, give up your marriage, give up your wife, give up your husband, give up the church. And so many things give up your job, or there are strange voices. They know that that is not making them happy, but something very strange voice is trying to drive them to do that. You know why often people hear that? Because one main reason, when God spoke to them, maybe earlier or sometime ago, the right thing, they did not listen. They rebelled against it. When we fail to listen or rebel against what God speaks, then they will start speaking. He gets a chance. So many people I have seen, and so many means not hundreds, at least I would say dozens of people, they get a spirit of suicide. Kill yourself, kill yourself, kill yourself. Or kill yourself this way or that way also. Devil may even tell the way to commit suicide. You know what? Why it's? Because one day they received the word of life. They refused to listen or obey or accept it. And when we, not only about that, any other area where when we get the right counsel of God, we deliberately rebel against it, then we get the wrong counsel. One of the two comes. Either you will receive the right counsel, or you will get the wrong counsel. Either there will be light. If you don't want light, what do we get? We get darkness. We cannot say that I don't want light, but I don't want darkness either. No. Either you need the light, or you need the darkness. Which one are you going to choose? Sometimes, when God's counsel comes, people can be prejudiced. For example, against the preacher. You may not like the preacher. Then what happens? You may not like the preaching as well. Even if an angel of God is coming and speaking through that person, I know that person, you know. I know about him. These people only know now. I know all his past. Anyway, so when the servant of God will, or whoever may be starting the word of God, they will shut off their ear. And then they will hear devil speaking. When we recall about Daniel, the first about the dream that the king had, and so nobody was able to interpret. Then it was told there is a man called Daniel. So the king told, yes, quickly bring him. Of course, it was not Joseph. Daniel about, no one astrologers and nobody could interpret that. So the king made a decree, kill all the wise men. And then, when Daniel heard about it, what did Daniel do? Daniel boldly went to the king and asked time to interpret. So the king straight away gave him time. Already the executioner has gone out to kill everyone. But here, the king was giving a chance, a time for him. In fact, all night. Next day only, he was going to tell the interpretation. So, king could have prejudiced himself. This is a slave boy come to this country. He is from our enemy's country. Who is going to listen to him? After all, he is from my enemy's country. Maybe he may bring something to plot to kill me or something. Anyway, who is going to listen to a slave boy while all the wise men of the whole world, all the country could not do anything? If he had been prejudiced, he would have lost the great chance. So also we find about Joseph when Pharaoh could not find anybody to interpret the dream, and butler told, here is a man in the prison. Straight away he told him, bring him in. A man who is in the prison. And what was he? He was a slave. What is his past reputation? He was a man with attempted immorality. Who is going to listen to him? If Joseph had been standing and preaching, and you know about Joseph who was a slave and who was in the prison, and what a rumor going on, not a rumor, it is almost confirmed, like, you know, Joseph was an immoral man and standing here to preach, who is going to listen? But here we find the king listened to it, and that became a great blessing. So what I wanted to emphasize while mentioning, if you are often listening to strange voices, you should repent. Because somewhere you might have rebelled against the counsel of God. Deliberately. If you keep on deliberately rebelling against the counsel of God, you will hear stronger and stronger and stronger the negative voice coming to disturb you. Or to, how many people, at least some people I know, they killed themselves too. They obeyed the strange voice. Sometimes people can be prejudiced against preachers. Some may be prejudiced against sisters' teaching. Don't we? Sisters, sometimes some people don't like sisters' teaching or preaching. And then so, Bible says, women should not open their mouth, they should keep silence. I think that what happened when Jesus gave the message, first one who received the message of resurrection was Mary. And we see Mary, what we read, she rushed, she ran to tell the news. How many of the disciples believed when women went and gave the message? How many believed? No one believed. And particularly we find about that the two people who were going to Emmaus, they were so thoroughly discouraged, and Jesus walked with them. And they told, why are you? And he drew near and walked with them. Asked, why are you like that? Oh, some women came and told they had some visions. That's what. Then Jesus rebuked them. Didn't he? None of the disciples believed what the message came through the women. Nowadays also people, there may be some people, if it is coming through sisters, they don't want to accept. Are you like that? There may be some people seated like that here too. Anyway, it's whatever is, wherever it may be, that's very interesting. Please read John chapter 20, verse 17 and 18. Then we'll go to the book of Daniel. Chapter 20. Verse 17 and 18. Yes. Jesus saith unto her, touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord, and that he had spoken these things unto her. And none of them believed. In another place is, she ran to tell. She was so excited. But none of them believed. And because they did not believe, what happened? They all were thoroughly discouraged. And Peter became the ringleader of backsliders. Went up, went to fish. Anyway, now we'll come back to important things in book of Daniel. Now we learned about the visions and dreams, how we have to be careful. If you find any dreams or any voice that you are hearing is not sure from God, you have the right to tell the Lord, Lord, I am confused about it, therefore don't speak. Then God can speak directly from the Word of God. Word of God is steadfast and sure. And that too, by the way, when I am telling you, God can speak through the Word of God. Don't be like us. I told you a person, you close the eyes tightly and open up some portion, and you hear and you see, oh, you Babylon, the mother of all harlots, and this, you get frightened. Again, you read something else, you know. You find, I will destroy you, oh, this and that. You get more frightened, and then again you close your eyes and open. Don't do that way. That is not the right way to hear the Word of God. Pray in the presence of God and wait upon God. Then God will either give a verse, even in our mind God will put a verse, or else the reference God will give. So wait for God's time. Don't be hasty about even hearing the Word. Don't say that now I need to hear the Word of God, therefore you just open the Bible somewhere. And you know, that will depend upon how the markings in the Bible and where you are normally, you know, opened, or the, where the, you know, all the stitchings and things connected with that often, you may get that portion coming also. So, listening to the word of God does not mean simply just all the time opening the Bible. There are times, definitely. There are some times Holy Spirit will really speak and gently speak to us to open the word of God. Or the reference will be given. That is one thing. And now, coming back quickly to Daniel that we find, Daniel had visions. Here in this vision, what was he seeing? From the chapter 8, we'll come back to. Then I lifted up mine eyes and saw, and behold, there stood before the river a ram which had two horns, and the two horns were high, but one was higher than the other, and the higher came up last. I saw the ram pushing westward and northward and southward, so that no beast might stand before him, neither was there any that could deliver out of his hand. But he did according to his will and became great. Then fifth verse. And as I was considering, behold, and he God came from the west on the face of the whole earth and touched not the ground, and the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. Here we find, in fact, what we find in the book of Daniel, so many visions or meanings are given through symbolically animals. So many animals we find in this. Once again, we'll show that one day, some time ago, I had shown that so many animals we find in that. Holy Spirit wanted to convey a particular message to us. See, one animal like a bear, one is like a lion, and one is like a leopard, and another is a fierce animal with horns. And again, we find below there is another lion-like animal, and then we find a he-goat there with a he-goat has got a horn right in the middle of its eyes, and there is a ram. So many animals are found. That's enough. Thank you. So, what does the Holy Spirit want to convey? There is some particular message God wants to give. All these animals, one important meaning is there. Every animal shows a kingdom in this book of Daniel. All the animals represent, of course, fallen type of kingdoms, or worldly kingdoms. These, from the animals that we found, as I told some time ago, they, all of them appear to be wild, untamable, cannibalistic, and furious type of animals. No divine qualities at all we can find. These animals are represent, here also we find an animal. In the fourth verse says, one animal about a ram pushing westward and southward, etc. And then fifth verse we find a he-goat coming there. Word of God says in 49, Psalm 49, we read verse 20, man that is in honor and understandeth not is like the beast that perish. Now listen here. If you are a child of God who love possessions, honor, respect, you will be like an animal. Man that is in honor and understandeth not is like the beast that perish. These beasts are naked. They are not clothed like human beings. So, all these animals, in the book of Daniel we find the power struggle for them. One animal is, particularly in this fourth, fifth and sixth verse we find, when a ram is coming with two horns, then we find a he-goat is coming and destroying the ram. So, what God wants us to know, if you seek position, honor, respect in the world, you and I can be like a beast that perishes. But saints should not be like that. Here, about the beast, the fourth verse, what we find, I saw the ram, what did it do? the ram was pushing. And then, the fourth verse ending, but he did according to his will and became great. Do we have this nature in us? How did this animal become great? How did this animal become great according to this text? It was pushing. Sometimes we also can. We can become great by pushing and pulling for possessions. That is beastly nature. Two ways we can become great. One way is that the way this animal became great was, but he did according to his will and became great. When we do our own will, we can become clever, and our fallen intelligence and brain we can use to get a higher position and greatness in the world. But then finally, you know what happened to this ram? We find the seventh verse. And I saw him come close unto the ram, and he was moved with choler, means anger, against him, and smote the ram, and brake his two horns. And there was no power in the ram to stand before him, but he cast him down to the ground, and stamped upon him, and there was none that could deliver the ram out of the hand. So, this ram was completely vanquished, cast down to the ground, stamped upon him, and all his power gone, is completely humiliated. That can happen for us too. If we seek the positions in the world, honor in the world, greatness in the world, we can come too. But the end will be, as it's written here, cast down and destroyed. When I was in Sri Lanka, when I was so surprised, in no other country I have seen the president of that country's posters. I'm not exaggerating. At least 30, 40 or 50 feet tall, big posters. That country is going through civil war and so much of privation and poverty. But this president's posters, so big and high, so expensive. And wherever he goes, so much of decorations, this and that. I was wondering, how could they afford all these things? How this man is so much honored or respected? Later on I realized, not that he was honored or respected. He was pushing himself forward. And sad to say, some of you might have heard that how that man was killed by a bomber, 14-year-old boy. It was arranged by some people. But after that president was killed, there was such a great jubilation in the country. People were like a festival, they were if I'm right, they were really rejoicing and dancing, happy because that man was dead. So perhaps he might have pushed and pulled himself and came to a great limelight, but suddenly see the way, die on the road, even his body was mutilated. Anyway, God forbid, let it not happen to any one of us. What I wanted to say, when we are living in this world, be very careful. How? The way that, two ways we can become great. One is doing our own will. When we do our own will, we will push ourselves. As it's written, the ram pushed and became great. And the other way to become great, like Daniel and other saints, they did the will of God. And in those cases, they humbled themselves. And that greatness could not be taken by the enemies at all. So when we do the will of God, and then greatness that is coming, no man or devil can take out. And in that case, we will be humbling ourselves also. And then we find the sixth verse, and he came to the ram and had two horns. Of course, the historical facts, at least a little bit I may tell. This ram represents Medo-Persian Empire. And this he-goat represented Greek Empire. And the horn represented Alexander the Great. the first king of Greece. Anyway, in this study, my intention is not to give importance to the historical facts, but only to the spiritual facts. That is why I am avoiding all the... I also have to confess, I am not a very expert about all the historical facts of those. There are so many things connected with that. But I try to avoid, because they are not going to edify us to know all the historical facts and prophetical importance about so many things happened, connected with so many Jeremiah and other other books. They are good also to study. But my primary purpose is that, God willing, we will study just devotional aspects, the spiritual aspects, things which could help us for our spiritual life. So this, he suddenly it became so great, and it came with, in the sixth verse we find, he came to the ram, that means the he got, that had two horns, which I had seen standing before the river, and ran unto him in the fury of his power. Some people have got only one power. What is that? The fury of their power. Some people's only power is their anger. Nothing else they have. If anger is the only power that is dominating in your life, you and an animal, wild animal, has nothing distinction, nothing to differ. Some people can give up everything, but they have no victory over anger. Earlier I told one of the studies, people, those who are no victory over anger, their life will be very fluctuating life. As I told, I told the example of a man, anybody remembers? I don't expect you to remember all the things anyway. That was few weeks or months ago. But if you remember, tell. Saul. Well done. Thank you very much. So you got remembrance. So we find Saul's anger. But we also learned how he was so unsteady. Often he will take the javelin to kill David. And number of times afterwards he repents and says, "Oh, my son David, my son David. Oh, your lovely voice. I'm glad to hear." He was so fond of David-like. But suddenly changed. Same chapter again says, taking 3,000 people and going to kill again. So what I wanted to say, let me emphasize, I don't need to repeat again. If you are a man with anger in your life, I don't think you have any place in the kingdom of God. I don't think you can ever grow to be a saint. You will always be a double-minded person, up and down. One day when you hear, maybe weekend you may be an angel, and from Monday to Friday could be a devil. You can never, because the spirit of anger is a murderous spirit. That don't try to control. Controlling a lion is no good. Controlling a snake is no good. You have to kill the snake. You have to kill the lion and destroy that. Should come out of you. Thank God, by the grace of God, God delivered me, but from the terrible spirit of anger. But still I know at times it's trying to come back. Don't think once it goes, it is going to sit idle. It may try to, that spirit will try to come back. Here we find about the fury of his anger. And as I told, the he god stands for, is a Greek empire. And the horn is standing for Alexander the Great, the first king of Greek. Eighth verse says, therefore, the he-goat waxed very great, and when he was strong, the great horn was broken. For it came up four notable ones toward the four winds of heaven. Anyway, that is a history how Alexander suddenly died, and four of his generals took over the whole empire. Alexander started conquering the world when he was 20 years old. And when he was 33, he conquered the whole known world. And after that, he wept. Somebody asked him, why are you weeping? Because there is no more world to conquer. That was why he was he was weeping. He was such a disappointed man, and history says then he became an alcoholic because he got so worried. Why he was worried? Because he had no more countries to conquer. All the known countries he had conquered. So history says in different ways. One story says he died of alcoholism. But somewhere else says that while dying he told, "Don't keep my hands inside the coffin. Put my hands out so that the world may know I am going empty." Anyway, whether it is a true story or not, I do not know. But one truth we can learn, that young man, with all his stamina, strength he had, he simply wasted his life. All his life was just battles and battles and battles. And why I want to mention that, sometimes you and I also can be like Alexander. Don't put the word Alexander the Great. I don't think that is any greatness. What was his greatness? What was he all his life doing from the age of 20 to 33? All what he was doing was fighting. Now may I ask you one question? What are you doing in your inner man? Some people always have struggle. Fighting. Sometimes husband and wife fighting also every day. Don't be an Alexander. Keep on fighting and fighting and fighting, fighting. He was a man of war. He told Solomon will build because Solomon is a man of rest. If you don't have a victory on the unsanctified nature, some people cannot get on with others. All the time there's a clash. Either you pick on the other person or that person will pick on you. Or when you see that person, it's an eyesore for you. Or the other person sees you, it's an eyesore. And they cannot get on well. I asked one couple, husband and wife, "Are you getting on well?" Then he told, "Pastor, we have no problem because I come from work and come home, and then my husband will leave for the night duty. And when he comes home, and then I'm ready to go out. So we don't have any problem." Is that the way that we live? So what we find, there are so many animals mentioned here. And finally, what happened to this he got? It became great suddenly, and suddenly its great horn was broken also. Dear children of God, what Holy Spirit wants to speak to us? Any position and honor, anything that we get through, our own pulling and pushing and doing our own will, one day it will bring it will bring a great disaster. But when we humble ourselves and meekly we are willing, bearing all sufferings and difficulties, then we find the final. Saints, some time ago I told, saints will have the final power and authority. Now sinners' world, we are living sinners' government. But saints' government is going to come. If tonight Jesus is going to come, then after 7 years, the saints' government will start. And they will rule the world with peace and grace. Those who now rule their own lives, they only can rule others. Now why the world has got so many problems? Because the people who are not able to rule their own life, they are trying to rule others. They cannot. If you cannot rule your family, you are not fit to rule anyone else. If you cannot rule, one man of God says, if you cannot discipline your own body, you cannot discipline the body of Christ, the church. So what God wants, dear children of God, in these days, this animal's character, nature, we should get rid of and get that divine nature. So many animals are mentioned in this here. All of them show worldly fallen powers, worldly empires. But God is preparing a group of saints for his kingdom. There are so many beautiful qualities that we find about Daniel in this very chapter is full of many truths, but few things that I would like to mention more. One is the Daniel chapter 8 verse 18. Now as he was speaking with me, I was in a deep sleep on my face toward the ground. But he touched me and set me upright. I just purely want to tell spiritual meaning. There are so many historical and prophetical importance that I may not know much of them, and I would rather choose to speak the spiritual meaning. Now, I ask you, are you like this person in a deep sleep? Now, as he was speaking with me, I was in a deep sleep. Have you seen people like that in the meetings? I will read it again. And you just see whether it is applicable to or not. Now, as he was speaking with me, I was in a deep sleep. I will not ask to raise the hands. How many of you fell into deep sleep when he or the Holy Spirit or anybody else was preaching? But the encouraging thing was that in spite of that, he touched me. That stands for the Lord Jesus Christ. That verse 16 and 17. When he touched me, what happened? Then set me upright. When God touches our heart, then we become upright. If you are not upright in your life, if you are crooked in your Christian life, the reason is that you did not let God touch you. When he touched me and set me upright. In Luke's gospel also we read a similar truth. A woman, she was hunchbacked woman. She was doubled up. And she came to the house of God. Although she came to the house of God, she could hardly look above or look at Jesus. Because she was really, word of God says, for about 18 years, she was bowed down. And she was, perhaps she was only looking to the earth. But the Lord has seen her in that stage, we read. And the Lord called her to himself. And then what Jesus did, he touched her. Immediately after Jesus touched her, as we read here, word of God says, he was made straight. Sorry, she was made straight. And then what did she do? She glorified the Lord. Some of you are in deep sleep in spiritual life. Like as we read in the 18th verse, now as he was speaking with me, I was in a deep sleep on my face toward the ground. But that but has such a great importance. But he touched me and set me upright. Dear child of God, tonight you need a real touch from God. I do not know to whom I am speaking, because you are not right with God. Your personal life is not right. Your secret thoughts are not right. Your secret life is not right. But therefore you are spiritually in a deep sleep. Although you are hearing the word of God through your ears, but in the spirit it doesn't go in. But we read, but he touched me. Tonight I believe God wants to touch you. I tell you, till God touches you, you will not be upright. You cannot be upright. Like the hunchbacked woman, when Jesus touched, she was made straight. Are you straight before God? Is your life straight before God? In your money matters, with the government, with the office, with God, is it straight? Are your thoughts straight before God and man? Is your personal life straight? If not, what we read, he touched me. And I was made straight. Tonight, I believe God wants to touch you and me. Unless God touches you, you are not going to be straight. But the problem with you and me, sometimes we don't let God touch us. We are so proud. We think that we are all right. But when God touches we will be upright. When God touched that man, the blind Bartimaeus, immediately he was able to see Jesus and he followed him all the way. Dear child of God, I believe tonight the Lord has come to touch us. He touched me and I was upright, I was made upright. Shall we all stand up? If your life is not upright, you may be spiritually in a deep sleep. But I want to tell you, God is speaking. Now as he was speaking with me, I was in a deep sleep. I have seen some people literally in deep sleep also. I have to confess, I also slept. But for you and me, tonight God is here to touch. Do you want to be really upright? Lord, I want to be upright before God. About my thoughts, about my words, about my deeds, about my personal life, about my finances, about everything in my life. I want to be upright. Shall we all pray? Jesus. 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 Hallelujah. Amen. Jesus. Praise ye Jesus. Come and sing. Amen. Now the singers will come and sing.
Jesus. 558.
Maybe in your life, you may be like the person we read. As he was speaking to me, I was in deep sleep. But he touched me and I was made upright. You may be feeling tonight you need a touch from God. So many areas of your life, you may be crooked. You may be bent down badly. You may be doubled up. You are so, you're bent up in a bad shape. But he touched me, the word of God says. Although he was in deep sleep, the Lord touched. Tonight, God really wants to touch you. What are areas of life you find your life is in a mess? It's not straight at all. Just come forward and stand. I believe God is going to touch you and me. I really need a touch from the Lord. He wants to make us straight. He touched me and I was made upright, word of God says. You receive a touch from the Lord tonight. Right from the head to the sole. Right from the crown of the head to the sole of our feet. Receive a touch from the Lord tonight. Even the man who had a deep sleeper, not listening, God could touch. How much more God wants to touch you and me? Jesus. Jesus. By faith you receive a touch from the Lord. By faith you just receive a touch from the Lord. You don't need to give up hope. The man who was in deep sleep while God was speaking, God did not forsake him. The man who was in deep sleep while God was speaking, he touched that man. If God touched that man in deep sleep, he can touch you and me now. And he was straightaway made upright. Yes, every area of your life and my life, the Lord is here to touch and to make us upright. Believe it. Upon God, you believe and believe that touch of God is already in you. Every area of your life, you may be messing up with your time. Maybe your eyes may not be upright before God, heart may not be upright. Nevertheless, Word of God says, "But He touched me, and I was made upright." You believe that tonight. And by His grace we are made upright. Shall we all praise God for that? and thank you for this time that you have given us, O God. We believe tonight, O God, you have touched me, O God. I, Lord, in so many areas of my life, I was in deep sleep, O God. Now I realize it, O God. Although I preach to others, Lord, Father, you have been speaking to me the areas where I have been deep sleep. But thank you, Lord, for touching me tonight. Thank you for letting me appoint, O God. Father, we pray, Lord, let thy word, Lord, richly be, Lord, rooted in our hearts and minds so that it may bring forth not 30 or 60, but 100-fold for thy glory. In Jesus' precious name. Now may the peace of God that passeth all understanding rest and abide with us all, now and until the Lord returns in glory.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
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 God bless you.